Dr. McLaughlin, the Professor of Social Science here, and also Associate Director of our Bishop Center for Ethical Leadership and Civic Engagement. And I am really excited about the forum that we have for you tonight, and the format of this forum is going to be different, and I think something we're going to find very engaging. So I want to thank first our sponsors, which are the Bishop Center, Student Government Association, the League of Women Voters, and Localshops1. Our debate tonight is going to focus on economic development and small business here in St. Petersburg. We have a panel of experts who are going to be asking questions. You will see in your, there's programs on your tables, on your chairs. And I want to especially thank Esther Venozio for putting the program together and for Localshops1 for printing the program. But let me introduce the panelists who are here. Professor Bill Jackson, who's Professor of Entrepreneurship here at USF St. Petersburg. Jack Kim, who is small business owner. He owns the Three Birds Tavern here in St. Petersburg. Mark Lombardi Nelson, who is president of our Student Government Association. Linda Hersey, who is a freelance journalist. And Mo Minozu from Localshops1 and vice president of Buy Local. You know the election is coming up on November 5th, and the last day to register for this election is on October 7th. So if you are a student and maybe registered elsewhere and now you're moved here, or you might have moved, or you're not sure if something's changed, you must change up before October 7th. And the League of Women Voters is here, and they have all the paperwork that you need. So when you're finished the forum tonight, if you're not sure everything's right, please stop by the League of Women Voters table so that you can, your voice can be heard in this election. There won't be early voting in this mayoral race, but there will be vote by mail. So if you don't think you can make it to the polls on November 5th, please also see them for the paperwork to request a mail ballot. So the format, I said, was exciting, engaging, different. So what will it be? We're going to have the first 40 minutes will be questions from our panelists who are experts in the field. And each candidate gets 60 seconds to respond to the question. And we have a built-in rebuttal for every question. So I'm excited about that. It seems like a lot of forums is an answer, then you move on. And when the candidate doesn't really get to respond to what they wanted to from the previous question. So there's rebuttals for every question. Then we're going to have a lightning round of yes, no questions. And then we're going to have the questions from you, the audience. So please, we've got those smart USF students, USFSP students, they're circulating with those cards. Please make your voice heard. We're going to call up from back to this table by 6:15. So I think that wraps up the forum. And now what we're waiting for is our two candidates for mayor, Mayor Bill Foster and Rick Kriseman, and we would appreciate if you gentlemen would take your places at the podium. I should note that the views expressed by the candidates don't represent the views of the University of South Florida St. Petersburg or the forum sponsors. Not that they're going to say anything crazy, I'm sure, but just so we're clear on that. Also, if you could just check now, make sure your cell phones are turned off. And of course I'd be remiss if I didn't thank, we have two other sponsors tonight, our food sponsor for the reception, with special thanks to Helena Jacobs and Island Flavoring Tanks for the delicious snacks at the reception, and also Chris Nikolic and the ABI SPL for a generous donation for the AV equipment that we needed to run this debate. So thank you very much. Okay, without further ado, we're going to get started and in round one of our panelists' question. And first up is Professor Bill Jackson from USF St. Petersburg.
Mayor Foster, Mr. Kriseman, welcome to USF St. Petersburg.
While the small business community in general is the lifeblood of our economy, research has shown that high growth entrepreneurial firms generally account for most of the economic growth in a community or region. What would you as mayor do to support high growth entrepreneurial firms?
I think we've already started on that endeavor. And thanks to USF St. Pete and the St. Petersburg Chamber of Commerce, we created the Greenhouse, which is all about entrepreneurial training. It's everything from startups, it's everything from businesses that want to grow from 5 to 10, and it's everything in between. So it's relocation, it's entrepreneurial training, and I know that Gazelle Labs has been invited to that, as well as SBA and all of these other organizations, to really try to grow businesses in the city of St. Petersburg. And how we take care of entrepreneurs and their preparation as they go on, it's a partnership that we established with USF St. Petersburg to make sure that they are teaching a curriculum here, whether it's here, St. Pete College, Eckerd College, to make sure that we're teaching the curriculums and having it available to our local students, to where the jobs are actually out there, that they, when they get their degree, they're not asking, do you want to supersize that, but that they actually have a job within their trained field waiting for them when they graduate.
Well, thank you all for first off, thank you for coming tonight. This is an important debate. We already have the Tampa Bay Innovation Center, which has been in existence for a number of years and has been involved in the incubators and helping to really start to grow the businesses here. But we also do need to expand our involvement with USF St. Pete, with Eckerd College, with St. Pete College, on all of the universities we have in our area. Because I don't think we've really taken advantage of the talent pool that we've got potentially to work with. We also need to look at the way that we as a city do business and the rules and regulations that we put in place, and what roadblocks are we putting for businesses that want to move here, that want to locate and try and grow. In addition, I think it's important to work with our local financial institutions to try and free up dollars so that those businesses that do want to locate have the resources, and those that are already here have the opportunity, especially in tough times, to get those resources they need.
I get to use my rebuttal. We've never had that. This is very special. Mr. Kriseman mentioned the Tampa Bay Innovation Center, and through a partnership with that organization and the Greenhouse, we, within the next week, I think, we'll have the unveiling of, I think it's called the 1 Million Cup of Coffee Initiative, to where two startup companies get to pitch their product or pitch their business in front of entrepreneurs, in front of mentors, and they get to have this experience with a mentor, with the business community for support. I think that's an exciting initiative.
Our next question will come from our panel, Linda Hersey.
Thank you. Welcome. Some small business owners assert that companies west of MLK are largely ignored by the city and often are struggling. Do you agree with this assertion? And what, if anything, can the city do to help independent business owners outside the downtown core survive and flourish?
Thank you for that question, Linda. And yes, I do agree with that. One of the things that I've done during this campaign is what I call a small business tour, where I've gone to businesses all over the city, but in particular outside the downtown area. And it's been fascinating, because when I ask them, you know, has anyone from the city ever visited your business to find out how you're doing and what they can do to help you, the answer is no. Actually, I should correct that. The answer is yes, and it's typically codes. So the one visit they have with someone from the city is someone who's telling them something that they're doing wrong, something that they need to fix, instead of how can we help you survive? What can we do as a city to make it easier for you to do business and survive? So I do agree. I think that we have not done a very good job, and that is something in my administration that I will make a regular part of my time as mayor, is to do a small business tour throughout the city, and I'm not going to tell them when I'm coming, so they're not prepared, because then I'm going to get the real truth.
Great question. Naturally, I disagree with that assertion, because when you think of the geography west of ML King, we have the Edge District, which we are going to fund. Hopefully the council will approve my recommended budget. We're going to put $24,000 in seed money to work with the Edge District to make sure they get established. You have Grand Central, which I think is a thriving, beautiful, wonderful, artsy community of small businesses. Then you go out to West Central, and you look at this the Central Avenue redevelopment plan, as you tie Bogusiega Bay in with Tampa Bay and everything in between. So we're actually looking at how can we help these small businesses? How can we connect them all together? And then you look at 34th Street South redevelopment, the plan that we're going through now, to really tie in these businesses of 34th Street South. All of those are west of ML King, and we have initiatives to make sure that they grow and prosper.
Very quickly, let me first thank you. The mayor mentioned his greenhouse project, and I'm glad he's finally done that, but it took 1,648 days from the time he took office to the time that plan was unveiled. The Central Avenue Corridor project is a very important project, but like a lot of things in the city right now, it's stuck in quicksand. It's not moving forward. Half the businesses that are along Central, and I've knocked on a lot of those doors, have no idea that plan is even in place or that there's something going on there. You can't get the businesses engaged if they don't even know what's happening.
Thank you. Our next question comes from our panel, Simone Venezia.
Are there any specific city departments and regulations that you feel should be changed to better support small business? If so, please give specific examples of the type of company who would benefit from that change.
Well, the department, you know, anything we can change, we do. And so I want to make sure that we have no impediments to job creation and economic development in the city of St. Petersburg. The greenhouse and before that, the Business Assistance Center was very much a part of that. And it took a while to get to the greenhouse, quite honestly, because when I became mayor, we had a chamber that was quite frankly dysfunctional. We had a chamber leadership that had been gutted. And so it took a while to find this visionary named Chris Steinacher and to rebuild trust into a St. Petersburg chamber that we felt comfortable doing business with and really working as partners. So, but we remove impediments, whether it's in construction and permitting. You remove impediments and you have somebody hand-holding throughout this entire process. For the first 2 years of my administration, we were able to lower taxes. And so we create these environments conducive to economic development. But yes, occasionally it's hand-holding, but sometimes it's just get out of the way and let them grow and let them come into fruition.
Mo, I'll give you two specific examples, I think, of things that we ought to be looking at. One does deal with permitting, and while the city has gotten better, there are still significant impediments in place. I have heard from talking to developers, and I've had a number of conversations when I've been going around to different breakfast places, of if you have one person that comes in and does an inspection, and they tell you it's okay to do that, if that same person doesn't come back to do an inspection, you may get a completely different answer as far as that it's approved. And instead, you might get flagged. Now, that delays your project, and it costs you money. And that makes it difficult. The second example I'll give you is signage. And there's a balance when we talk about signage. But there's a business on 22nd East Boutique that I visited. And they said that the one visit they had from the city was Coates, who told them they had to take their sign down. He said, nobody knows I'm here. How am I supposed to keep my doors open when people don't know I'm here? There has to be a solution, a compromise, where we protect the integrity of the city, but we allow the business to do business.
We've done a great job removing impediments. When I think of what construction and permitting was like when I took office, we've used technology now. We have online permitting and review processes, and we work through any of those challenges. It's the goal of this administration to get you your CO as soon as possible. Yes, there are times where there are life safety issues with fire marshals and things like that, but to remove these impediments, we've done that. It is not in our best interest to not get you your CO. You gotta be open for business.
Our next question comes from panelist Jack King, small business owner, CP.
Gentlemen, the city of St. Petersburg grants tax breaks to mega corporations like Walmart to develop property and create jobs within the city. Should similar tax breaks be granted to small business?
I almost feel like this should be part of the lightning round question. The answer is yes. And you know, the small businesses in St. Petersburg, and we shouldn't be ashamed to say this, but St. Pete's a city of small businesses. You know, and not that we want to turn away Fortune 500 companies, because we don't. We want to welcome them here too. But what gives us our unique character and flavor are small businesses like Freebirds. And we ought to be looking for things that we can do to make it easier, and if it is incentivizing, it is, for them to come here, to open up, and to survive. And it also means, again, working with our financial institutions that we have that are local here. to see, because there are times when it's tough to keep the doors open and you need just a little help. So we need to be working with them too to try and help the small businesses. But yeah, I think we're a city of small businesses. We need to embrace that because it's what gives us our character.
Well, we use the systems that are in place, the QTI, Qualified Targeted Industries, and these are tax credits for jobs created, high-paying jobs, well-paying jobs. The state system, and we use matching dollars, and it involves the city, the county, and the state of Florida. These processes were set down in place by Tallahassee. If they're broken, he had 6 years to fix it, and he didn't. But I don't favor using general ad valorem fund dollars to give any types of credits to small businesses, the taxpayer dollars. I do think that we can find better ways to incentivize by making it easier for the businesses to open. But these are credits. So if there are credits and if there's a system in place where we can use our credits for job creation, then I would say yes. Now, depending upon which zone you're in, if you're in an enterprise zone, you can get tax credits for every single job that you create. So there are systems in place depending upon where and the nature of the business. But general fund, none.
Yes.
Well, thank you. When you look at small businesses in St. Petersburg, and in general, typically the pay is better, and that's really where the majority of your folks are hired from the community. You can bring in your Walmarts, and they'll hire a bunch of people initially, but they're all low-paying jobs, and the future and the potential for growth is not the same. So where we really see the biggest impact on the community, both in jobs that are hired and in pay, are in small businesses.
Thank you. And our next question is from panelist Mark Lombardi-Nelson, our student government president.
Good evening, gentlemen. I'd like to ask, what business experience do you have that makes you the best candidate for mayor of St. Petersburg?
I think it's me. I'll tell you the best thing I can tell you is I have been the CEO of the fourth largest city in the state of Florida for the past 3.5 years. I've managed over 2,700 full-time employees and managed an annual general fund budget in excess of $200 million and have led this city through the worst recession and mortgage foreclosure crisis we've ever seen in our history. And yet constantly looked at customer service and creating these environments for job creation and economic development. I worked very closely with USF St. Pete to make sure that you secured $5 million from the state of Florida to start the process of building a school of business. So all of these relationships and experiences that I've had for the past 3.5 years, along with 20 years as an attorney running my own practice, makes me the most qualified candidate as we go forward into the next 4.5 years. That is intense job training, and now is not a good time for on-the-job training, I can assure you.
Well, and I'll address your question in a second when we talk about on-the-job training. The last two mayors have come into this job with no executive experience, and there's been a big difference when you look at the successes of those two mayors. So it isn't about necessarily the experience, it's what you bring to the table as far as leadership goes. But to address your question as far as understanding small business, my dad started up his own business, and it was in a warehouse it was about 12 by 12 when he started. When he sold the business, it was about a city block long. And I worked at his business every year, and I talked to him constantly to see what he was doing. And I learned a lot of things about how do you succeed and how do you grow your business, but how do you treat your employees and how do you get the most out of people? Because that's what also helps make your business be successful, is if you treat people right, you provide good service, and you have people who work for you who are dedicated to you because of the way you treat them and because they want your business to succeed.
Well, I'm glad his father was an entrepreneur and had the experience. He didn't answer the question until you his experience. But when you look at what we have been through and the environments that we have been able to create, in spite of all of the things that wanted to press us down, to be on track for $400 to $450 million in new development, where you can't look at the city skyline without seeing a crane, without 200 trades on the job, knowing that every one of those places will be occupied and jobs will be created, we focused on the details. So having tens of millions of dollars less than my predecessors, guess what? We did more than with less than anybody.
Thank you. Now we're moving to round two. Bill Jackson.
Research has shown that universities are a tremendous asset for cities and a major driver for economic development in those communities fortunate enough to have one. In light of the funding problems state universities have faced in Florida over the past several years, what would you do as mayor to help in reversing this negative trend?
Well, one of the things that we need to continue doing is to work and advocate in Tallahassee. And one of the things that I think is very important is that all of the mayors, that we work together as a group to speak to the larger community in Tallahassee about the importance of funding universities. It doesn't do any good necessarily for one person to do it on their own. We're much more powerful if we go up there together as a group and lobby. But we've got to keep putting the pressure on, because if we don't, Tallahassee's going to continue to do what they've done, which is to cut funding or to take money out of your funding and give it to other places where it wasn't intended to be. But your words are very true. It is critical to our community. It's critical to the state that we have a strong, vibrant university system.
And thank God for St. Petersburg. We have three. We have three really good institutions of higher learning, the USF St. Pete, Eckerd College, and St. Pete College. And I have great relationships with their presidents, with their boards. And I think the proof is in the pudding of how I did advocate and spent a very long weekend advocating for that $5 million for the School of Business, something that the governor was going to veto. It helps to have a friend in the governor's mansion. And I kind of crack up every time Mr. Kriseman talks about having to go to Tallahassee and lobby. He spent 6 years in Tallahassee and didn't accomplish a thing. Now, he will tell you that it's because I'm a Democrat and they're all Republicans and I can't play nicely with people, but I know a lot of Democrats in Tallahassee that brought things home, especially in education and other things. So it's no time to make excuses. 6 years, really, nothing.
Yes, and I appreciate Mr. Foster's comments. It would have been nice during my 6 years that I was in Tallahassee if Mr. Foster had been up there every session during his term in office to advocate not only for public education, but for all those other issues that impact the citizens of the state. For example, we've got a big issue that's on the horizon right now dealing with flood insurance. And we haven't heard a thing from Mr. Foster as to what his administration is doing to deal with an issue that could cripple our economy and the growth that we're starting to finally see in home sales.
Maybe somebody will ask us about it. I'd love to share that.
Okay, so we're on to the next question, Glenn Dennerson.
Thank you. The city is starting to develop a downtown waterfront master plan that creates a blueprint and vision for key properties to the city, its residents, and the tourists who visit here. Given the value that the master plan is expected to have in charting growth and ensuring the downtown's economic vitality, do you think it would be prudent to wait until this document is complete and approved before making any major decisions about redeveloping the pier?
I think those two processes will coincide, and I think they will go side by side. And with the one thing I learned from the 828 Alliance and a subsequent council meeting, there's still very little consensus, even with the city council and members of the community. So the 828 Alliance recommended a survey. We're in the process now of writing a detailed survey as to exactly what you, the people, want out over the water. We're also going to prepare an RFQ to make sure that we can attract, and consulting with AIA to make sure that we can attract a really good world-class architect, even the world-class architects that are right here in Tampa Bay. So we're going to go along with that process, because having no peer is not an option. We're going to take advantage of all the passion and drive of the people. But this waterfront master plan is so exciting because it involves so many other things, whether it's parking, transportation enhancements, park improvements, all these things that tie into this waterfront. So So I honestly believe that those processes will overlap and coincide.
Linda, in an ideal world, we would do exactly that. We'd have the master plan and then go forward with the pier. But we don't live in an ideal world because the administration shut the pier down, even though there was a question as to whether we were even going forward with the lens or with something in the alternative. So we don't have the luxury of time, unfortunately, because it is the jewel of our waterfront. We need to move forward. I think we move forward with the pier, with the visioning on the pier and coming up with a new design, and the waterfront master plan will then have that design to build around. And it's unfortunate, I read the 828 Alliance report, and I'm not really sure what happens going forward because it's been disbanded, as I understand. So I'm not really sure how we go forward at this point in time. I had put a process in place that would have gotten something potentially built by 2015. But I think, which is when, by the way, the waterfront master plan is supposed to be completed. So it would make perfect sense and follow perfectly in that format.
You hired me not to make emotional decisions, but to be a steward of your tax money. And when the city council voted to enter into an agreement with Michael Maltzen, guess what? It was my job to program it and build it. And every tenant out there on the pier had a year to find alternative places for their business. And when Richard Gonsmark came out and said, you know what? I can't make it till May 31st. When he wanted to close down, I begged him to stay open. But we closed it, and as a result of that, you are saving over $100,000 a month in a subsidy that is not being paid.
Thank you.
No. What kind of new business would you like to see emerge? And are there any types of small businesses that you believe there are too many of for our economy to handle?
Wow. Small businesses, drugstores, oh, is it?
Yeah.
Is it your turn?
It's my turn.
Oh, I'm sorry, I get so excited.
Yeah, the three areas that I would like to see us really grow and develop are is a marine science research park, a health sciences research park, and I'm going to call it a clean energy research park. Obviously, we have a pretty good idea, especially here at USF St. Pete, about marine sciences. And with All Children's and Johns Hopkins partnership and the partnership we've had with Shams, we can see potentially the growth of a health sciences research park. But when I talk about a clean energy research park, I'm talking about things like a small business like Lumastream, which is an LED manufacturer and is really cutting edge with some of the things that they're doing. It's solar power, it's battery technology, it's producing ethanol. Those are the things that I think I'd like to see us really get into, and I can see that happening more in the Dome Industrial area, whereas obviously we've got the marine sciences on the waterfront and the health sciences located right around all of our health facilities. But I think we've got tremendous opportunities in that respect.
Yeah, I still think we have too many banks and drugstores, but you know, Mr. Kriseman and I agree on this, and all of the things, the examples that he gave of successes, I was a part of. I was at the table. I helped make that happen. Meeting with the people from Baltimore to try to encourage Johns Hopkins to come into this medical corridor and associate with All Children's Hospital. A huge deal. To be at the table with HMA as they bring UF Shams. To be at the table with USF Health. To work on this medical corridor that is cutting edge, that will bring academics and research and cutting edge technology to this city. So everything from the Bay to ML King and Fifth Avenue South to Roser Park, that's going to be exciting. And you look at the marine sciences and what we've been able to do with the Ocean King, knowing that we have the most concentrated cluster of marine sciences, knowing that they're not going to stop drilling in the Gulf of Mexico, and our proximity to that water is a laboratory for job creation and research and fishery protection. These are the jobs that we're creating right now.
The only comment I'd make is that, you know, Mr. Foster was at the table at HMA. He was at the table at this. If he was at the table at HMA, then he surely must have known about the subsequent sale that was going to be happening. If he was at the table at Sweet Bay, he should have known that Sweet Bay was going to be closing, but nothing happened for a year. So if he was at the table, I don't know what he was doing while he was sitting.
Thank you, Mark.
So my question would be, what would you do as mayor to provide more opportunities for USFSP alumni to remain in the region after graduation?
I never thought it was going first anymore. USF safety alumni to stay in the region. You know what? You're a prime example of how a mayor has worked very closely with the student body and all of these things that they do to pitch ideas and entrepreneurs and things like that. But you know what? I think you're a prime example of a student who's gotten involved. And I'm going to speak for you. You haven't told me this, but I'll bet you you love St. Petersburg. I'll bet that you see this thriving downtown nightlife, that you see housing stock going up and all of these great things that you want to do. I think you know that we've worked on look, smell, and feel, and that we've worked on creating these jobs that are degree-oriented for you to go into. So I think I can speak for a lot of people that they love St. Petersburg, they want to stay. Now, this association that we have with USF St. Pete to make sure that there is a home shopping curriculum, a Jable Circuit curriculum, a Franklin Templeton curriculum, a Valpak curriculum, all of these curriculums that are tied in to jobs actually there for you when you get out, I think that's going to be the next step. That's going to be very important.
It is continuing to create jobs in the areas that I had mentioned previously with marine sciences and health sciences and clean energy. But it also, we can't lose focus on the environment that you're going to live in and being a city that is desirable to live in, which means that we continue to improve and focus on our cultural amenities and our diversities, our parks, our neighborhoods. We haven't had a chance to talk about neighborhoods yet, but we used to be a city of neighborhoods. For you to want to stay here, you need to have housing that you can afford and a neighborhood that's enticing to you that you want to live in. It's also dealing with public safety. You want to feel like the neighborhood that you live in, where you're working, is safe, that you can go to and from work safely, that you're not worried about being a victim of a crime, and that there's good public safety. So I think if we get neighborhoods right, if we get quality of life right, and we continue to create jobs, we're going to have an environment that's going to make you want to stay here.
You know, I think St. Petersburg is a very cool city. I spoke to a young lady tonight who has an issue with a skateboard, a longboard. Now, I would never dream of being on one of those crazy contraptions, but you know what? We are a young city, we got a great vibe, and I want to make sure that we create a city in these environments that you are attracted to, a place where you want to raise a family, a place that it's in our DNA, the creative classes, the arts, whether it's downtown or warehouse arts or these things that give you a respite from the day-to-day, that's what we created in St. Pete. It's exciting.
Thank you. And Jack King.
Gentlemen, visitors approaching St. Petersburg by highway see signs that read I-375, Baywalk, the Pier, and I-175, Tropicana Field. The first sign is currently obsolete, and the second sign may someday be obsolete. What will you do to move the city's image to a new one?
Thank you, Jack. That's a great question, and it's something that I've talked a lot about. Can you all hear me in the back? Let's start over again. Thank you, Jack. And that's a great question. It's something that I've been very concerned about because we do a pretty decent job, and not a great job, but a decent job of pointing people to downtown. But we do nothing in this city to celebrate the other areas of the city, to tell people what there is in other areas of the city. For example, I live in West St. Pete. Nobody knows, if you're getting off the highway, that there is a shopping district in West St. Pete. Nobody knows that the Woodson Museum is in Midtown. Nobody knows what else is around the city because there's no signage that really directs you to those places. And if you go to other cities around the state, or not around the state, but around the country, you not only see good signage that points out to those other areas, but those areas have distinct marketing district designations. And they celebrate not only restaurants and shops, but they celebrate the museums and everything else that there is in that district, so that visitors and residents alike know how to find things, they know where there are, and it completely changes the vibe of those communities.
I think I understand the question.
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
I'll make the microphone, but
I probably don't even need it because I'm loud anyway. You mentioned three projects that I think are still very relevant and pertinent to the identity of St. Petersburg. A pier. We've had a pier for 100 years. We're going to have a pier. We're going to build a pier. That sign will stay and direct people to the most beautiful waterfront anywhere. Baywalk is coming out of the ground. There are hard hats. There are trains there every single day. And that will be the destination going forward. We want people to go to Baywalk. You have to go to New York to find some of the really cool stuff that I know Bill Edwards is bringing to Baywalk. And Tropicana Field, guess what? As far as I'm concerned, we're going to have Tropicana Field there at least through 2027. Now, if you like this guy, they'll move. But I can tell you the Tropicana Field will be there through 2027, and I'm going to fight to make sure that the Rays meet their obligations to you, the taxpayer who has skin in the game, who brought them here. Those signs will always remain relevant.
Well, I can't let the comment about Tropicana Field and the Rays go without commenting on it. And I just find it interesting that Mr. Foster's position seemed to change when he was in the editorial board room, where forever he was against letting the Rays look outside the area, and all of a sudden he started saying it's okay. My number one priority is to protect the taxpayers' investment in that team, and that means doing everything I can to keep that team in St. Petersburg and to work with that team on a good faith basis to help them be successful.
Thank you. Now we go to round three, and Professor Jackson.
This will be somewhat of a follow-on question. If the Rays do leave St. Petersburg, and I hope they don't, what will be our strategy to fill the economic gap for the city after they leave?
That's a great question, and just it is a follow-up. And the neat thing is, he wants to be at the table. He hadn't been at the table, but I've been at the table. And when objectives and circumstances change, you have to adapt. If the objective is to keep the Rays here for the next 30 years after 2027, to have a long-term generational commitment to you, then absolutely Tampa should be at the table and they should look. But you know what? They're not going to stick it to the taxpayers of St. Petersburg. We're not going to take it in the shorts. And I will fight to represent the taxpayers of St. Petersburg. When I run for mayor of Tampa Bay, I'll have a whole different attitude, I promise. But I'm the mayor of St. Petersburg. Now, in the event there is a departure, and it's an ugly process, the most exciting urban renewal that we have on the books can be 85 acres of contiguous, unencumbered acreage for mixed uses of retail, commercial, convention space, green space, entertainment. I mean, this could be an intense urban renewal of 85 acres. That is exciting.
Having 85 acres is incredibly exciting, and I too, I'll agree with Mr. Foster. I think there's incredible opportunities. It is a parcel of land that you just do not see in this region even, that can be redeveloped. One of the other things that I would like to see happen with that parcel though is I'd like to see it off the grid. I'd like to see us do something really innovative when it comes to utilizing clean energy technology and whatever we do there. But as far as the Rays go, you know, I think it's great that we're having a business discussion now, because if you own a business, you know that when you're negotiating with someone, if you don't trust and have faith in the person that's sitting across from you, it's very difficult to ever reach an agreement. And unfortunately, the Rays have lost faith in Mr. Foster, and that's part of the reason that we haven't made any progress. This is an issue that we're still dealing with 4 years after he took office. And unfortunately, if he were to be successful in his campaign, we'll be dealing with it 4 more years.
Yeah, but they'll still be here. And they'll still be committed to the taxpayers of St. Petersburg. So when I think of, and I'm gonna go back to the 85 acres, because that really is the exciting thing. When you think of the intense mixed uses, he wants it off the grid, that's fine. I want it on the tax rolls. I want to make sure that there's something there that will replace the economic losses to the city incurred while it's being redeveloped. And I want the jobs that will be created there, high-paying, good, living wage jobs that will be created there. We can replace any economic impact, but it will take time.
The city is in the midst of developing a 34th Street corridor plan with the goal of attracting new businesses, jobs, and consumers to the area. Specifically, what do you think should be done to improve the economy of a business corridor that has many blighted areas and a lot of traffic congestion?
And I'm glad that we're starting to look at 34th Street, because when you think about it, we talked a little bit about Central Avenue before. Central Avenue and 34th Street are really the main corridors in and out of the city of St. Petersburg, east and west and north and south. So it's oftentimes it's the first thing visitors see when they come into our community is they see that corridor. And right now, what they're seeing is not something that I think any of us really would like them to be seeing. We take the model that we saw work in the Grand Central area. And a lot of it has to do with the communities around it, the neighborhoods that are around it, because one of the reasons that Grand Central has been as successful as it's been is it's had the support of the neighborhoods that have been in a partnership almost with the neighborhoods. We've got to get the neighborhoods that are around 34th Street really more engaged in this process, because it isn't just the businesses. If we don't have the support from the community, those businesses aren't going to be able to survive. So we've got to get not only have to focus on the businesses, but the neighborhoods that surround it.
I'm excited about this forum tonight. I've been waiting for this for a couple of weeks now. You all want specifics. Let me give you some specifics. You won't hear them from anywhere else, but you know the most exciting thing that we have going on right now are discussions involving a cruise port terminal on the outside of the Skyway Bridge. Guess what? They're building ships now that won't actually go into the Skyway. So there's a lot of talk and discussion about having a cruise port terminal on the other side of the Skyway, on the Pinellas side. Guess what? That will transform the city, transform 34th Street South and the beach community, and imagine 10,000 tourists turning over every couple of days wanting to find something to do, a baseball game, a happy theater, free fall, wanting to find something to do, Dolly, Chihuly, in the city of St. Petersburg before they embark and when they disembark. That is transformative. That will transform 34th Street South. That's my vision.
Well, and that only becomes transformative, that project, if people have a way of getting from that port to those shops, to those restaurants, and to those businesses that are located on 34th Street. And that's where Green Light Pinellas comes in, and that's where public transportation comes in. And I wish that this administration had been more engaged from the beginning with TBARTA and being a partner in trying to get public transportation enhancements here in the city, because it could make a huge difference on the success, not only of 34th Street, but of the Rays. We go back to them.
Thank you. Now I'd like to go to Mel.
Is there anything the city can or should lobby the state government on that would benefit small business?
Well, as far as changing some of the rules, whether it's enterprise tax credits, incentives, absolutely. I think that would be something that we could lobby for. I think tax credits for job creation is beneficial to the entire state. I also think that we've had a terrible failure with some of the way the funds are set about for university funding. Why is it such a hardship when you think about funding education? Why is it like pulling teeth? Why do we have to lobby so hard to fund USF St. Pete or St. Pete College and things like that? I think having a qualified workforce, I think having those that are educated, I think even down to secondary, high school, this entire educational system, I think having that educated workforce and an education system where your kids will be trained, I think that'll do a great deal to bolster economic development, job creation, and small business in the city of St. Petersburg.
Thank you.
you always have to look at tax policies and incentives to see what can be done to spur growth in that respect. And I too agree with the argument about funding of education. It's something that I often railed against, I wish I could say successfully, but unsuccessfully at times. But I also think we need to look at the potential workforce. One of the things that I've heard in going door to door from people is there's a lot of folks in our community who want to work and they want to get a job, and they're being prohibited from getting it because they've had an arrest on their record, whether it's a misdemeanor or a felony. And that's something that we have to change in Tallahassee, the way crimes are being converted from misdemeanors into felonies, because it's making a lot of people and taking them out of the workforce, and it's impacting the ability of businesses to hire people. Go out to Washington and bring money back for affordable housing and to work on housing initiatives. I think we've got to, there's several things we've got to do. We've got to bring resources back into the community. We have to look at code enforcement. We have to work with the banks that have foreclosed that are not, even though we've got a foreclosure registry, we've got to really do a better job of holding their feet to the fire, because if a structure next to your home is not being maintained, it impacts your property values. So we've got to do a better job in that respect. I think if we do those things, it can have an impact.
Yeah, we're going to have to talk fast. Tampa got more money because they scored higher on the blight scoring system. So they got a much bigger problem than we do. They probably need the money more. But as far as, and it's alphabet soup, it's NSP1, NSP3, Project Rebuild. A lot of these things subject to sequestration, that's a big naughty word, but we're doing the things in the Midtown community to try to do blight removal. Follow this study, this study that, of poverty, and make sure that we pass this CRA, this community redevelopment area, to make sure that we can breathe life into Midtown. But it'll have that ripple effect. Yes, it will take time, but blight removal, properties back on the tax rolls, land banking, new home construction, do what we need to do to get rid of the rentals.
Okay, next question. How are you, or are you, going to improve the flow of traffic near downtown, specifically one-way streets and access to the interstate?
Well, we do pretty well coordinating our street lights, by the way, and that's kind of a tedious process. But downtown traffic, we do really well with ingress and egress on First Avenue North and South. Your north-south routes are those that will need improvement. But one of the neat things that we're doing in furtherance of this university, some call it university place, but this medical corridor is working with FDOT to give people access to I-175 or whichever one that is, as you are heading north on 4th Street, to make sure that you can turn and get on that ramp without having to go into the medical cluster to get to 6. So there's a lot of things we're doing with FDOT. 4th Street is an FDOT road, 34th Street. And we're working closely with our partners to correct some of those things.
Back in the time that actually Mr. Foster and I were both on City Council, we started looking at a lot of the one-way streets that were in the downtown area and started converting them over to two-ways to try and create more energy in the downtown. I think we certainly ought to continue to look at those that we have left that are one-way and see if it makes sense to create a two-way out of them. Overall, when you consider our flow of traffic that we have in St. Petersburg to a lot of other communities, certainly of our size, but even of larger size, we do pretty well in St. Petersburg at getting people in and out. I'd much rather be driving around in downtown St. Petersburg than in any other downtown area in the state.
What will you do to improve conditions for ex-offenders to become employed or self-employed?
Yeah, and that goes right to one of the things I mentioned before. I know that, you know, the city as an employer, there are policies that the city can put in place and has put in place in some instances to encourage hiring of those who are felons or have a criminal record. But we can also incentivize private businesses to do the same. But the other thing that we ought to be looking at is, especially with juveniles, is when we see them getting arrested for, and I'll just call them ticky-tack crimes, they're minor crimes. But now they've got an arrest on their record, and they have a misdemeanor on their record instead of a civil citation that potentially they can get. And that makes it difficult to get a job, and it also makes it difficult to get into college, because the first question you're always asked is, have you ever been arrested, and have you ever been convicted? So I think we need to look really hard at increasing and really putting in place a solid civil citation program.
You know, if an ex-offender wants to become self-employed, and that was part of the question, all they got to do is go in the greenhouse. And they can come out of there being an entrepreneur. But you know what's really great about this city? I partnered with a local community activist 10 years ago to create the Community Law Fest. And out of the Community Law Fest, and it's coming up, there is a whole bank of attorneys right there, dedicated, ready to go, to work on nothing but restoration of rights. And you know what, that is a legal process, it's got to be done right. But if we can get their rights restored, then they don't have these challenges of getting a job and things like that. So I think a lot of these things come out of the grassroots, but this new procurement ordinance we've just passed through the City Council, I think that'll go a long way as well.
Yeah, very, very quickly. The most important story I heard while I was walking and knocking on doors was the person who's who is a convicted felon, was getting his GED, and he said, I can't get a job here in this city, and I don't want to go back to a life of crime. That hasn't changed in 4 years, and that shouldn't be the way it is.
What are your plans for promoting urban agriculture and related businesses in St. Petersburg? I'm Mayor Fosterwood.
Well, there's a lot of that going on, and we've got a lot of open space. I spent a little bit of time a few years ago going to Takamatsu, and every residence, every commercial property had rice fields and things, and so I started thinking about a program, Dirt is Gold, and I really want to spend the next 4 years partnering, using school board property that's been abandoned. We've got this Riviera Middle School site that I'm prepared to go to the school board if I can just find a co-op that'll farm the darn thing and be responsible for it. We can provide the mulch, we can provide the water, but there's a lot of open space out there if we can encourage people to not only do community gardens, but this is acreage. Let's have a farm.
We do have a lot of opportunities, and all you have to do is walk around a lot of the neighborhoods and you'll see vacant lots.
There you go.
Vacant lots that have a city sign on it that says no trespassing. And I sit and I look at that and I think, that's an opportunity that's being wasted. Instead of having a vacant lot next to somebody's house, that could be a garden. It could be a playground in that neighborhood. But it's just being wasted and it's being no trespass. Those are opportunities we have not been taking advantage of.
I'm certainly not going to develop an agricultural department in the city of St. Petersburg, but all it takes is somebody to say, you know what, I've got a plan, I'll be responsible, I want to partner with you, I want to grow vegetables on this site, and you know what, that's not a hard thing to do in the city of St. Pete.
I think we have time for one more question. Am I here? As the arts are an economic driver, what can the city do to support for-profit galleries and recreational?
Thank you. I am absolutely convinced that the arts are really what has spurred the Renaissance that started in 2000 and has really grown this community. But we can't. One of the things I want to make sure we don't focus in on when we're talking about the arts is we don't just get hung up on galleries. Because the arts is bigger than that. We have a real growing musical climate here in St. Petersburg. There's some great places where you can hear live music. There's opportunities for us to grow that industry like we saw in Athens, Georgia, where it became a hub for live music and for young musical groups. So I'd like to see us do more, not just with the visual arts, but with auditory arts. I'd like to see more public art around the city. And I think for-profits are like any other business that we have to be a partner with them and ask them, what can we do to help you be successful?
Yeah, and I'm actually going to answer the question. I think when you're dealing with a for-profit arts group, the key phrase is for-profit. And guess what? Arts is business. We did an economic impact study with the Art Alliance, and we know that arts is business. It's an economic driver. But we want to make sure that as we expand the potential use of public dollars and public arts, I ask the city council to expand this percentage of construction value that can go into public art projects that we can go to for-profit artists and they can bid on that. So we're going to see art with all of these projects from the pier to the police station to all of these economic opportunities that we have. We're going to see for-profit artists have a real opportunity to get a bite at the apple.
And briefly, if we pay the same attention to for-profit arts businesses as we've been paying to our other small businesses, I can understand why they're struggling. The city hasn't reached out and hasn't engaged with local small businesses to find out what we can do to help them, and that has to change.
Thank you. Now we're going to invite each of our candidates to give 90-second closing statements, and the orders were determined previously in the coin toss. I don't think I said that in order. We determined that the order of the questions as well. So Mayor Foster will go first in the closing statement.
Yeah, we did a coin toss. I lost both of them. Thank you all for coming out tonight. I know you have busy schedules and you could have been anywhere. but you're here tonight to listen to us. Thank you to the audience. Thank you to USF St. Petersburg and our panelists. Excellent job, and hopefully you think that we were worthy of your questions that we asked, and that we actually answered that. You know, this campaign is about ideas. It's about our visions for the future of our city. But part of having a vision, you can promise to pave the streets of gold and things like that, but part of having a vision and your ability to accomplish the vision is having a track record of success. And for 3.5 years, I've got a track record of success. And my opponent's I'm going to run on my record. I want you to really challenge him to run on his record. But aside from all the rhetoric, you don't have to look at brochures. You don't have to look at TV commercials. I ask you to do one thing. Answer 3 questions. Do you love St. Petersburg? And I think the answer to that is yes. And then I want you to ask the next question. Are we better off than you were 4 years ago as we broached this economic crisis? And third, do you think the city is going in the right direction? And then if the answer is yes to those questions, I ask that you support me so we can continue this momentum. Let's keep going. That's what this campaign is all about. God bless you all. Thank you for honoring me for being your mayor for the past 3.5 years. It's been one of the greatest honors to navigate this city than I've ever had. Let's keep going. Thank you.
Well, thank you all for coming out here tonight. My name is Rick Kriseman, and I am running for mayor. And for 6 years, I was honored to serve on the City Council of St. Pete, serving as the chair in 2005. I then served for 6 years in Tallahassee as a state representative. I've been married to my wife, Carrie, for 20 years, and we have 2 kids, Jordan and my daughter, and my son, Samuel. Like you, I love the city of St. Petersburg. That's why we're all here tonight, because we love the city of St. Petersburg. But what I really love is the potential for what St. Petersburg can be. And we're not going to get there by maintaining the status quo. We're not going to get there by not changing and doing things the same way that we've been doing them. We have to start moving forward. We have to start investing back in our neighborhoods so that we've got those vibrant neighborhoods that we used to have. We have to start improving our education so that we not only produce people who are capable of getting jobs, but we become an attractive place for people to move to because they know that that their kids are going to have good places to work. And we have to focus on bringing good quality, high-paying jobs to this community, something that hasn't happened in the last 3.5 years. And I encourage you to ask the question, are you satisfied with the way things are, or would you like to see it better than it is? Because it can be better. And that, to me, is what's exciting, and that's why I ask for your vote. We can be better, and with your help, I can make us better. Thank you so much.
Voters, Localshops1. I'd like to thank our moderators. I'd like to thank you for coming. If you'd like to know about more great events at USF St. Petersburg, our little yellow cards for you to fill out to be on our email list. And if you didn't get the voter registration, please stop by the voters' field for you. Thank you very much to our candidates.